Now, from the station on your side, this is Wavy News 10.
A tornado in effect for all these areas shaded in this yellow color. Find out where the storms are right now and where they are headed.
Changing our customer service culture.
This is the new head of ERC, Philip Chiquette, and we are talking to him about the new era at ERC. I'll have that story coming up.
A 12-year-old caught in crossfire. Will bring you an update on the late-night shooting in Norfolk.
I'm Liz Kilmer in Suffolk, where thousands of students stayed home from school today after bus drivers walked off the job.
First at 4, the weather, and we have video to show you from the first round of rain. This is a town center in Virginia Beach.
And now there's a possibility of strong, even severe storms in the forecast. Part of our area is actually under a tornado watch. Meteorologist Ashley Baylor is in the Super Doppler 10 Weather Center. And Ashley, what exactly are we looking at? I see a lot of green over there.
That's right. We do have these rather strong storms that have fired up off to our south and west. So just in the last 5 minutes, this tornado watch has gone into effect. Not to be mistaken for a warning. A warning means that it is imminent. A watch means kind of keep an eye to the sky, and a warning could be issued because remember, with any of these passing storms, there could be some rotation detected on radar, and that could drop a tornado with very little to no warning. But let's take a look at what's going on here. Across the metro, things aren't looking too bad right now. But notice farther out, just south of Emporia, we have this very strong thunderstorm. In fact, it has actually reached severe qualities. This is going to continue to move off to the northeast at about 25 miles per hour. So if you live in the western section of Southampton County here, just be aware that this thunderstorm cell is going to be heading in your direction again, moving northeast at 25 miles per hour. So it's not moving very fast. So in addition to the possibility that there could be some slight rotation within this thunderstorm cell, we're also concerned with the possibility of some hail, potentially in excess of a quarter size. It could actually be marble-sized hail, maybe even be a little bit bigger than that, possibly half-dollar size, and also some very heavy downpours. You can see, again, those splashes of red and pink there. So that's the severe thunderstorm we are tracking right now. Technically, not even in our viewing area just yet. And we also have some rain that we are tracking across the eastern shore. You can see all the way from Chincoteague down towards Cape Charles. We have some light to moderate rainfall. So that's what's going on radar right now. And the tornado watch is in effect for all these areas shaded in this yellow color. And that is set to remain in effect through about 10 o'clock tonight. It is going to take that long for some of these showers and thunderstorms to get out of here. You can see the first wave is gone. But now, since we've been tracking sunshine for the past few hours, it's basically making the atmosphere unstable and allowing these strong thunderstorms to develop. So it's going to get a little bit dicey over the next few hours here. So of course, we'll continue to keep an eye on things. We'll not only keep you updated on air, but we'll also keep you updated online on wavy.com and our Facebook or Twitter pages. So we have you covered from all angles over the next few hours as these storms move through the region. We're going to get into the finer details of exactly what you can expect over the next few hours and what you can expect tomorrow in our full forecast.
All right, Ashley, thank you. Now, there was some minor flooding around Hampton Roads today. This is on Effingham Street in Portsmouth.
And this is video from Ocean View in Norfolk of the street flooding there earlier today.
Our WAVY weather app helps you keep an eye on the weather wherever you are. It gives you watches or warnings, the latest radar images, and, of course, hourly forecasts.
Governor Terry McAuliffe says that he is taking the operators of ERC at their word, that they will change the way they do business. McAuliffe says after years of poor customer service, he now believes things will get better. 10 on your side, Andy Fox is at a news conference at Norfolk City Hall and joins us now from the downtown tunnel. Andy?
Yeah, what we heard today from ERC and from the governor is that ERC has got to get it right with customer service. There's no doubt about that. It's absolutely understood that that is the situation. Today at Norfolk City Hall, Governor McAuliffe reminded everyone last week, he called out the ERC owners, Macquarie Skanska, to improve customer service and change the way they do business. Several new initiatives were announced, including capping administrative fees at $2,200 and $1,100 if you are on the toll relief program. And then the governor pulled out a toll bill and ripped it up.
I will say to our citizen in Virginia and to any citizen who has a bill like this from the Elizabeth River Crossing, I have one message for you today. You take that bill and you rip it up and you throw it away. It's gone.
Every person that uses these tunnels or the MLK, one of our facilities, is not just a customer, they're a valued customer. and we're going to treat them as valued customers.
Philip Chouquette sending the message there is a new person in charge at ERC. He is also appreciative of what the governor did, but says don't rip up your paperwork because they will need that in order to help you get your refund if you are entitled to it. Go online to WAVY.com. We have all the information there for you about how you get in touch with them if you paid more than $2,200 in fees, because you can get reimbursed for that. They will be giving out $600,000 and 600 checks, we are told. So keep that paperwork. Coming up tonight on WAVY News 10 at 5, going through some of the other initiatives, some of them resulting from 10 on your side stories. We'll have all of that for you tonight on WAVY News 10 at 5 at the downtown tunnel in a new era of ERC. Andy Fox, 10 on your side.
Andy, thank you. Now to new information in a Virginia Beach murder investigation. Prosecutors say someone injected the victim with cyanide. 29-year-old Joseph Merlino III is charged with second-degree murder in the death of his estranged wife, Ellie Tran, on Valentine's Day. A police search of Merlino's home followed the attack. 10 on your side's Jason Marks was in court today when Merlino faced a judge. Jason?
Cyanide. That's what prosecutors say Joseph Merlino injected into Ellie Tran's leg. She died a short time later. Now, Merlino was in court today for a bond hearing. We learned a lot more about this case. He's accused of killing his estranged wife, Ellie Tran. Prosecutors told the judge that Tran had just gotten home on Valentine's Day when she was attacked. She was pinned down in her driveway, and poison was injected in her leg. They say the poison was cyanide. Prosecutors say Tran's home had surveillance cameras and captured the incident and shows Merlino at the time. The cameras were put up, according to prosecutors, because she was living in fear. Merlino's defense attorney says there was no way he did it because he wasn't even in the area, and that it's not Merlino in camera, it's someone else. He says at the time he was at his brother's home near Farmville, and his brother and mother can testify to that.
Mr. Merlino is a successful businessman, and he cared very much about the mother to his child and his child, and it is heartbreaking.
Merlino's attorney doesn't believe that his client is a flight risk, though prosecutors disagree. They say they have evidence that Merlino has a fiance in China and was about to leave and flee the country, even had a plane ticket already bought to head that way. Now, coming up tonight on WAVY News 10 at 5, you may remember Merlino's home was raided just days after this attack. So what did the bomb squad find? Well, we found out today in court. Had that story for you at 5. For now, that's the latest here at Virginia Beach. Jason Marks, 10 on your side.
Thank you, Jason. A 12-year-old boy is the victim of Norfolk's latest shooting. Police say the boy was inside his home on Gough Street when a bullet from gunfire outside hit him. 10 on your side's Deanna LeBlanc is working on this story today from our WAVY newsroom. Deanna?
Yeah, Stephanie, I went by that home today and a woman who came to the door told me she's still in shock, but that the boy is thankfully recovering. Now, police believe someone fired from a parking lot diagonally across the street from the boy's home. The shot went through the house and hit that 12-year-old boy we just learned in a bedroom. Now, it is an area, Gough Street, that is not a stranger to crime. There's a memorial for another shooting victim right in front of the parking lot where the shooting happened last night. Now, many people we tried to talk to in the area told us they were afraid for their safety and did not want to go on camera. Another woman told us she's ready to move.
Yeah, this is crazy. It was just a shooting like a couple days ago over there on Park Avenue. It's time to get out this neighborhood because the next time it might be my son. I don't know.
And this afternoon, we also noticed Norfolk's chief of police leaving the victim's home. We've reached out to the department to ask a spokesperson, is that routine or a special circumstance? Well, we'll let you know when we hear back. In the newsroom, I'm Deanna LeBlanc. 10 on your side.
Virginia Beach police say a suspect is in custody for a hit and run. The crash happened Wednesday morning on Northampton Boulevard. Investigators say an SUV hit someone on a motorcycle and kept going. The motorcycle rider has life-threatening injuries. Police say they arrested 38-year-old Michael Jones for hit and run, reckless driving, and driving with a revoked license. A little girl hit by a bus this morning in Portsmouth should be okay. This story broke during WAVY News 10 today on Fox 43. It happened around 8 o'clock a.m. near Lincoln Street and Piedmont Avenue. Police say the driver wasn't going very fast when the bus hit a 6-year-old girl who ran out in front of it. The girl has a bump on her head and some scrapes.
New at 4, surveillance photos from a restaurant robbery in Newport News. Police say it happened around 10:30 last night at the Popeye's Chicken on Jefferson Avenue. The restaurant was closed for the night. Employees say an employee was counting the money from the registers when a man came in with a gun through an unlocked back door. Detectives say he told everyone to get out and fired a gunshot into the wall. Investigators say another man then came in the back door. All five employees ran out the door to a nearby gas station and called police. Police say the suspect stole money and ran out. Also new at 4, pictures from a bank robbery in York County. These are surveillance photos from the Union Bank on Route 17. The sheriff's office says a man walked in around 12:30, approached the teller and implied he had a gun. After the suspect received money, he ran out. Luckily, no one was hurt.
New information in the investigation into the death of a Portsmouth City employee who was killed on the job behind a city building. What 10 on Your Side uncovered in court documents.
Plus, why leaders of our local Habitat for Humanity chapters say the president's budget proposal could be devastating for Hampton Roads.
Out with the old and in with the new. What Crayola announced today about a new crayon.
But first, we'll take you out to the ball game. The Baltimore Orioles are taking on the Norfolk Tides right now at Harbor Park. And sports director Bruce Rader is there. Check that out, a live look right now through Tower Cam 10.
A happy sight for the folks at the game right there. Meteorologist Ashley Baylor is up next with your 4 p.m. forecast.
Side. You're watching WAVY News 10 at 4.
Back now with a live look at Super Doppler 10 radar and a lot going on that screen.
Oh yeah, a lot of green. Meteorologist Ashley Baylor is just minutes away with your full forecast. But first, under President Trump's budget proposal, the Department of Housing and Urban Development could see more than $6 million in cuts. That's about 13%. That should be billion. It's something the director of local programs called devastating for Hampton Roads because they say they won't have the funds to build homes and provide shelter. Those involved with HUD and programs like Habitat for Humanity tell me it's not just a problem for those who need the assistance, it could affect business owners too.
We want people to be good teachers, we want people to take care of our neighborhoods, we want them to take care of our parents, we want them to help serve us food in the restaurants. Where are they supposed to live if they can't find an affordable place, either to rent or to own?
During the year, the local chapter of Habitat for Humanity builds up to 20 homes. Now, the president's proposed $54 million budget includes cuts to programs to offset increases in defense spending. Coming up at 5, just how many people this could be affected by this in Hampton Roads.
A big event is going on right now for baseball fans at Harbor Park. In fact, I'm getting pictures right now.
You are, and they're so cute. The Norfolk Tides are taking on the Baltimore Orioles. Sit on Your Side, sports director Bruce Rader joins us live from the game right now.
All I can say is Ashley Baylor and Don Slater are the greatest forecasters when it comes to weather in Hampton Roads history. As they predicted last night, the Baltimore Orioles fly into Norfolk International Airport this afternoon. It is driving rain. They get on the buses, they come to Harbor Park, and the sun comes out and it stops raining. The Orioles leave Florida after being in spring training for several weeks, but on their way back home, they stop here in Norfolk so they can play an exhibition game right now against their AAA team, the Norfolk Tides. The Orioles manager, Buck Showalter, told us, hey, everybody's glad to be here.
It's humbling to think that somebody may miss half a day's work or whatever it is, but you know, when you, our guys understand the gig here. It's an honor to be asked to come here. It's one of the reasons why we have a good relationship with Norfolk, and then I can't imagine a better AAA major league situation we have than we have with Norfolk.
Now, as you may have heard, longtime Tides general manager Dave Rosenfield passed away a few weeks ago. You know, it's funny. This is the first game, except for maybe a few when he was sick last year, that he has missed in over a half a century. You know, even when the Tides had a big game and the weather was bad, it always seemed that the weather would break just before the game. So the people that worked here at Harbor Park used to call this the Rosie Dome for Dave Rosenfield. And even though Dave isn't here, everything worked out and we're able to play ball. By the way, the Orioles are winning 1-0 on a home run by J.J. Hardy. We also have some news in Norfolk. Old Dominion football coach Bobby Wilder has signed a new contract for 5 years. I'll have that story and more from Harbor Park coming up tonight at 6 o'clock on the Sports Wrap live at Harbor Park. And at least the weather's nice now. I'm Bruce Rader.
And he hit the nail right on the head with that one. At least it's nice now. Hopefully they can get in a good amount of innings before the sky opens again.
Yeah, because a big part of the area is under a tornado watch right now, right?
Yeah, primarily the south side and through northeast North Carolina, so I got to get right into it here. Here's a look at our Super Doppler 10 radar. And yeah, across the metro, we're looking all right for right now, but if you want to look off to our west towards Southampton County, that's where we are tracking a severe thunderstorm. And I actually have my phone out as well because, you know, I like to look at a couple things at once here. And so you can see this area shaded in this pink, purple color right here. Now, even though it doesn't, you know, look as terrible here, I'm looking at the velocity scope basically on my phone, and does seem to hint at the possibility for a little bit of rotation just north of Branchville and just west of Boykin. So if you're out in that direction, be careful because you could see a rotating wall cloud, and when you do see something like that, it can drop a funnel cloud or even a tornado with very little to no warning. So, you know, typically we'd be looking for a hook, but we're not really seeing one. So again, there could just be a rotating wall cloud within there. But right now, just a severe thunderstorm warning set to remain in effect until 4:45. Basically, the storm is now moving off to the east at 30 miles per hour. So set to be closer to Boykins at about 4:19. So about right now. And then Cortland 4:32, Franklin at 4:47, Carsville at closing in on 5 o'clock, and then Loomis a little bit closer to 5:12. Now that's if this storm can actually hold on to severe limitations by the time it reaches the city of Franklin, and again by the time it reaches the city of Suffolk as well. But we're primarily concerned at this point with this storm producing some very strong winds, potentially in excess of 60 miles per hour, and potentially also ping pong ball size hail. So that's what we were talking about yesterday, that the primary threats with any severe weather that developed was going to be hail and some strong winds. But again, I looked at the velocity scope, and there is possibly some rotation right now just north of Branchville and just west of Boykins. As we look a little farther to the north up across the eastern shore, we mainly have light rain stretching from Chincoteague down towards Cape Charles. So that's not a huge deal. Again, this tornado watch set to remain in effect until 10 o'clock tonight. That's for all these areas shaded in this yellow color. So it does include the metro, the south side, and northeast North Carolina. It does not include the eastern shore, does not include the middle peninsula or the northern neck. It includes some parts of the peninsula. As we put things into motion for you with our satellite and radar composite, we did have one severe thunderstorm warning that went in effect earlier today. That was with this first batch of rain that went through. But now we've seen the sun break out for the past few hours, and that sun is working against us. It's destabilizing the atmosphere and allowing these storms to actually gain some strength here. So that's why it's looked pretty bad over the past few hours. We've actually watched these storms really develop across northeast North Carolina and again out towards 95, and now they're kind of heading in our direction. So as we look at our convective outlook, we remain under the slight risk for obviously some isolated strong severe thunderstorms. As I said, the primary threats with these storms would be some strong gusty winds, potentially again in excess of 60 miles per hour. We could be looking at some decent sized hail over a quarter, possibly ping pong ball or even golf ball size hail. Flooding, not as big of a concern, but when you have those heavy downpours, you can see that ponding and puddling on the roads. I know there was some hydroplaning a little bit earlier, even on the main roads. And again, there's still that possibility for some rotation. Again, maybe a funnel cloud, could see a tornado drop. So this is definitely something you need to be aware of over the next several hours as that tornado watch remains in effect until 10 o'clock. Temperatures are in the mid to upper 60s. We even have some low 70s. Winds are sustained out of the south, and as we put our future track forecast on for you, you can see that most of this should be gone by the time we get to 10 o'clock. That's why that watch is only in effect through 10 o'clock. Here we are by tomorrow morning. We'll be waking up to a mix of sun and clouds. We'll have a mix of sun and clouds as we head through your Saturday, and temperatures will be in the upper 60s. So you know what? Actually heading into the weekend, we're looking a lot better. So we really just have to get through the next few hours. Here's a look at our 7-day forecast. Mostly sunny and 60 degrees on Sunday. So looking good through the entire weekend. Of course, we'll keep you updated with these storms over the next next few hours right here at WAVY.
Well, here's what's coming up in our next 90 minutes of news. I'm Anita Blanton in the WAVY Live Center with a look at some of the things you'll soon see. No hit zone. Next week, a new initiative will be announced and you'll begin seeing signs you've likely never seen. It's all about positive parenting, although doctors in Chesapeake are well aware not everyone will see it that way at first. Stephanie has the inside scoop. And we're also looking into a widespread problem that just doesn't seem to be going away. We all know the flu is no fun, but why are cases still on the rise even as seasons change? And it's finally time for the grand opening of what city leaders and developers are hoping will be one of Norfolk's great attractions downtown. The ribbon has been cut, entertainment has been booked, and rooms are already filling up at the Main. See these stories and more when Tom Schaap joins me beginning at 5.
Dozens of bus drivers call out sick. Thousands of kids miss school. Could the same thing happen again on Monday?
But first, no longer endangered, how things are improving for manatees. Crayola says it's picked out its new crayon color.
Yeah, and the company wants you to name it. Crayola says it will ask the public to help name the blue-shaded crayon this summer. The company says it will reveal more information on the new color in May.
Crayola is retiring the yellow color dandelion to make room for the color in the box of 24.
Well, manatees are now off the endangered species list. U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services are upgrading the status of the West Indian manatees from endangered to threatened. So that means manatees are no longer in danger of extinction, but their numbers are still small enough they could be protected and should be. There were only a few hundred Florida manatees in the 1970s. Well, now it's estimated there are around 6,600. Some environmentalists argue the new classification wasn't scientifically justified and that manatees are still in danger. An unusual scene in a furniture store. We'll explain why deputies ended up dragging an alligator inside on a leash.
But first, the aftermath of this freeway fire, how long it could take to repair the damage.
And right now at 4, meteorologist Ashley Baylor is working on your updated forecast.
And Don Slater is also tracking the weather outside as we have some severe weather potentially. So stand by for the latest for both of them coming up. Here's what's ahead this half hour on WAVY News 10 at 4. Kids missed school today after dozens of school bus drivers in Suffolk called in sick.
A North Carolina 5-year-old girl suspended for what she did while playing with a stick. Hear from the mother who says the school overreacted.
And 4 people pulled from the water after this boat crashed into a pier.
And a special dinner date for one police officer will warm your heart. We have that story coming up.
But first, we want to get right to meteorologist Ashley Baylor.
Yeah, because we have some severe weather that you're tracking right now, including tornado watch.
Yes, we do have a tornado watch that is in effect, and I'm actually looking at both our Super Doppler 10 radar, and I do have another one on my phone, so I can actually look at radar and the velocity at the same time. Velocity will tell us whether there's rotation detected within any of these storms. And I will say this storm that we are tracking that is moving through Southampton County right now looks like there is potentially a little bit of rotation being detected, specifically closer to Newsom's now. So if you live near Newsom's and you happen to see anything rotating out there, why don't you let us know. Why don't you go to our Facebook or our Twitter page and just let us know exactly what you're seeing out there, because you know what, the radar can only tell us so much. But we have the severe thunderstorm warning set to remain in effect until 4:45. That's for this area shaded in this orange box. Let's take a little bit of a closer look here, and you can see right now some of the heaviest rain is falling around and just north of Boykins, and this is going to be moving off to the east at about 30 miles per hour. So in addition to obviously some very heavy rain, there is some frequent lightning as well. The primary threats with this would also be some strong, potentially damaging winds in excess of 60 miles per hour. And I wouldn't be surprised if you saw some pretty decent sized hail, if you saw maybe ping pong ball sized hail out of this storm. And again, there's the possibility of some weak rotation. This is again going to continue off to the east. So it'll be closer to Sunbeam right around 4:39, Franklin at about 4:50 or so, Elwood about 5 o'clock, and then Whaleyville moving into the city of Suffolk at about 5:20 or so. So we'll continue to monitor this storm very closely. A tornado watch set to remain in effect until 10 o'clock this evening, and we're basically going to be dealing with rounds of some strong, potentially severe thunderstorms. You can see there is more just west of 95. Here's a look at Tower Cam 10, where we are seeing some sunshine, and that is working against us. That sun is actually destabilizing the atmosphere and allowing these strong to severe thunderstorms to develop. So it could get a little bit rocky over the next few hours. To talk more about that, here's Chief Meteorologist Don Slater.
Yeah, as we approach the 5 o'clock hour, then into 6, and possibly through our 7 o'clock newscast on Fox 43 News at 7, we could be with you a long time this evening. As those thunderstorms enter the Hampton Roads cities, quite likely by around 6-7 o'clock, we'll likely see a lot more action going on. Now, to give you an idea of what's going on, again, this is for the Hampton Roads cities. Around 7 o'clock, that's likely to be the worst of it in terms of seeing scattered thunderstorms into the region throughout the area. That's what's going on with that. After that, 8 o'clock is better, and then at 9 p.m. will be dying off considerably. So that's what's going on with that. But again, there's one area that we're seeing out there. We'll watch it carefully for you. Ashley will have more coming up in a few minutes. I'll have a lot more at 5 o'clock.
Don and Ashley, thank you. Thousands of Suffolk students stayed home from school today as nearly half of the district's school bus drivers walked off the job.
Yeah, drivers say they deserve better pay and benefits.
If they don't receive them, parents, well, they could be left scrambling again on Monday.
10 on your side, Liz Kilmer joins us live outside Lakeland High with the new details. Liz.
Yeah, well, more than 100 bus routes were canceled today as drivers are fighting for more pay. Now, the school says after listening to their concerns, officials have already agreed to give all drivers a raise, but it just wasn't enough to get those dozens to show up to work today. Now, 68 bus drivers did show up, but 67, about half, called out. Their frustration ignited after learning the superintendent received a much higher raise than the 2.5% they've been offered. Now, the division allowed parents to drop kids off early at elementary schools this morning and agreed to excuse all absences. About a third of all students stayed home. Kids who got dropped off by their parents, well, their parents say that they support the bus drivers.
It is inconvenience for the parents, but everybody needs to be valued. The cost of living has went up, so that pay needs to be in line with what these people are going through.
We need better wages, we need insurance, and we need a better retirement plan.
Now, drivers were offered an extra $50 to pick up additional routes today. The school tells me full-time drivers have received raises for the last 5 years. The one being offered now, we're told, well, it could have drivers calling out again on Monday. Now, meantime, the school tells me that they didn't have any more teachers or cafeteria workers call out than they normally see. We're going to have much more on this story, more on the history of bus driver raises coming up on WAVY News 10 at 5:30. For now, I'm live in Suffolk. Liz Kilmer, 10 on your side.
Liz, thank you. We're getting a clearer picture of what happened when a Portsmouth City worker was murdered while on the job. Willie Allen was checking out a pump station alarm. A few hours later, he was found shot to death. Set on your side, investigative reporter Chris Horn has new documents that show the progress in this case. Chris?
Yeah, Laura, we looked at these search warrants filed this week that show Portsmouth police have a suspect in the shooting death of Willie Allen. That suspect has not been arrested, but it is someone Allen knew. Willie Allen answered that alarm call about 4 a.m. the morning of January 10th. The pump station was on Ray Street. That's just a few blocks from our studios here at WAVY. His body was found about 5 hours later with multiple gunshot wounds. Detectives found footprints that led to a convenience store nearby on Effingham, and that convenience store's video gave police further clues that led them to a suspect who, as I mentioned, is still at large. Police say the suspect took Willie Allen's phone and used it to text several times after Allen was shot. They are also getting phone records from the suspect's mobile phone for the 90 days leading up to Allen's death. Allen was 56. He'd worked for the city of Portsmouth 35 years. We'll have more coming up in 1 hour on WAVY News 10 at 5:30. Live in the newsroom, Chris Horn, 10 on your side.
A North Carolina school principal has suspended a 5-year-old girl for using a stick as a pretend gun. Brandy Miller says her daughter Caitlin was playing with her friends. The two other girls pretended to be a queen and a princess. Caitlin was their security guard. Miller says a boy on the playground came up to the girls and Caitlin pointed the stick at him. She pretended it was a gun. The boy told a teacher who sent Caitlin to the principal. The school says what Caitlin did was a violation of the school policy against violence and threats. Her mom says the school overreacted.
I think obviously the weapon should have been taken away from her, and her told, we don't play like that at school. You know, we can't pretend to hurt other kids in school. And if she didn't listen, have her sit out a recess. You know, a timeout, it would have done it for her.
We have to ensure the safety of all of our students, and anytime a student feels threatened, we have to take that seriously and act accordingly.
An attorney for the school board says some school system employees have received threats over the decision.
Still to come ahead at 5, it's been 1 year since a local Virginia State trooper was shot and killed. How people are honoring his memory.
But first, here at 4, no hit zone. What this means for people in one Hampton Roads city.
And text NECK. How your electronic device may have a long-term negative impact for you. Stick with us. You're watching WAVY News 10 at 4.
your electronics could be hurting you.
Physical therapists say they're seeing more patients to electronic devices. That includes text neck. That's the strain you get from looking down a lot.
Hand injuries can lead to problems up the neck. Also, prolonged sitting in front of a computer, for instance, coupled with bad posture, is the perfect storm for pain.
Cervical strains, tension headaches, impingement syndrome of your shoulders, back pain. Our bodies are like this pulley system. So as soon as you compromise one section of the pulley, everything else is going to get thrown off.
This shouldn't hurt your
shoulder. Experts say there are some simple fixes to avoid it, like holding your phone at eye level and using more than one hand or finger to type.
They also remind you to stand up and move once in a while if you sit at a desk to prevent bad posture at the computer from causing any more issues. Also, keep your feet flat on the floor when sitting for prolonged periods.
Still ahead at 4, lucky to be alive, what an elderly woman had to do after being stranded in her car for an entire week.
And a rare sight, why police had to drag an alligator through the inside of a furniture store.
Well, we just had the severe thunderstorm warning updated. It is now in effect until 5:30 for Southampton County, the city of Franklin, parts of Isle of Wight County, and the city of Suffolk. So we're going to show you exactly where this storm is going and when it could be in your neck of the woods. That's coming up next.
From the station on your side, you're watching WAVY News 10 at 4.
Chesapeake is positioning itself to become the first no-hit city in the state. I got the inside scoop today on a program that will be officially announced next week. Signs like this one will be popping up at the health department later this spring, then at Chesapeake Regional Hospital and social services offices. All Chesapeake City offices have been invited to participate as well. Now, the signs indicate a safe zone where every man, woman, and child is safe from hitting or spanking. Much like no smoking signs, the city health director hopes the message will cause people to reflect and help change habits.
We're not here to condemn someone or to judge someone or to tell someone they're wrong, but that's a part of our education. And I'll be attending the classes as well, and I'm a pediatrician, but it's a part of our education so that we can be sure that everything's handled respectfully and compassionately.
The no-hit initiative will be formally announced on Monday during a Pinwheel Garden dedication to recognize Child Abuse Awareness Month and Public Health Awareness Week. If you'd like to attend that event or a free positive parenting talk from a national expert, I put all that information for you on WAVY.com.
Authorities are working to find out what sparked a massive fire on the I-85 freeway in Atlanta at the height of the evening rush hour. After burning for about 40 minutes, an elevated section of the freeway just collapsed. The inferno erupted underneath the 85 in an area used to store construction materials, equipment, and supplies. There weren't any cars on the section of road at the time of the fire. Traffic stopped, though, when drivers first spotted the flames. No one was hurt. The Department of Transportation says the damage will require extensive reconstruction to ensure driver safety. Officials say it's going to take a couple of months and millions to rebuild. The interstate is a major artery for the South and a thoroughfare for traffic heading north and south through Atlanta. Georgia's governor has declared a state of emergency. An elderly Colorado woman is alive and well after getting lost and spending nearly a week in her car. 85-year-old Ruby Stein was trying to get onto Interstate 70 when she got lost on a remote, muddy dirt road. Her cell phone didn't have a signal. Her car battery eventually died, drained by the flashing lights she hoped would bring help. Stein fashioned a makeshift blanket from clothes she had in the car. She melted snow on the dashboard for water and rationed sweet rolls and Rice Krispie treats to two bites a day. After 5 days, a couple of hikers spotted her vehicle. The sheriff's office says the Good Samaritans saved her life.
You know, stopped and peeked in, you know, since the car door was open, and asked if, is everybody okay? Is anybody in there?
It really reinforces that there's something greater and bigger than us, that we were meant to be there.
I kept myself very calm, which surprises me. Of course, when you raise five kids, you know, you... I've always been a strong woman, a strong person. I believe in whatever happens, happens for a reason.
She did have company, though, her cat. Stein did have food for her pet and says at one point she wondered if she would have to eat that to survive. Take a look at this video of a capsized sailboat slamming into a fishing pier. This is in California. Woo! The wind carried the boat into rough waves last night and smashed it into pieces. Rescuers pulled four people from the water. They received treatment for mild hypothermia.
An unusual scene caught on tape inside of a Florida furniture store. Deputies dragged an alligator on a leash through the business. Employees first spotted the gator in the parking lot and called the sheriff's department. And, well, the shortest path to the pond outside in the back was through the store and out the back door.
I can't make that stuff up. A Massachusetts police officer is raving about a recent dinner date.
A little girl noticed that he was eating alone at a restaurant and pulled up a chair to keep him company. It was all caught on camera.
Reporter Kim Lucy talked to the officer and the little girl.
And the police.
Lillian Israel looks up to police officers. Well, she does look up to pretty much everyone since she's only 3 feet tall and 3 years old. But police officers are on a whole different level.
I think that they're nice.
A few weeks ago, while she and her parents were at the Panera in Hingham, she noticed an officer in line for food.
She gave me five. I high-fived her back.
Leaving her parents and baby brother behind, she decided to have dinner with her new friend.
Because I wanted to sit with him.
I had an empty seat there, and she looked at it, and I said, you can sit, sure.
Sergeant Stephen Dirth, father of two girls himself, was thrilled to have such a talkative dinner partner. Surveillance video inside the Panera caught the whole thing on camera. Lillian says she talked about her favorite movie.
Little Mermaid.
The Little Mermaid is a classic, but that's not all Sergeant Dirth says Lillian had to say.
We had a great conversation. I learned a lot about her. She's very social, very outgoing.
He hopes more kids will be as outgoing and say hello to a police officer when they see them around. As for Lillian, he believes she has a bright future ahead.
Just her nature, from that short interaction I had, she could be whatever she wanted to be.
Oh, she's cute.
We all love her. Yeah. I would love to have dinner with Lillian.
Me too. Sergeant Dirth gave Lillian a junior police officer badge sticker.
Yeah, he hopes that she will share her experience with her friends.
Mm-hmm. So
adorable. I love
Absolutely.
Kids. I know.
We got some important things to talk about in the weather, though, right now. We're still tracking severe weather.
Not as cute as Lillian, that's
definitely
for sure.
Not.
We do have some strong thunderstorms to talk about. We have one severe thunderstorm warning that is in effect for Southampton County, parts of Isle of Wight County, the city of Franklin, and also the city of Suffolk. So let's get right to our Super Doppler 10 radar, where you can see things are turning a little more active. And I tell you, what worked against us today was the sun. Just seeing the sun break out for a few hours that destabilized the atmosphere and help these thunderstorms develop and actually strengthen them as well. Now, let's zoom in a little bit closer, and you can see this orange box here. That's the severe thunderstorm warning set to remain in effect until 5:30. Now, in addition to seeing some heavy rain there, you could potentially see wind gusts in excess of 70 miles per hour. So the storm has actually gained a little bit of strength over the last 50 minutes that we've been on air. And you could also see some large hail, possibly the size of ping pong or even golf balls. So you really have to look out for this storm. And it's going to continue to move off to kind of an east-northeast direction at about 30 miles per hour. So it'll be a little bit closer to Carsville at about 5 o'clock, Kenyon at about 519, Suffolk, downtown Suffolk, closer to 527, and Nansemond around 533. So again, this storm continuing to move off to the east-northeast. We have this tornado watch that is set to remain in effect for all these areas shaded in this yellow color until about 10 o'clock tonight. So in addition to seeing some strong winds and also some large hail, wouldn't rule out the possibility of some rotation within these thunderstorms that can drop a funnel cloud or potentially a tornado with little to no warning. So you have to take these warnings very seriously. Here's a look at our satellite and radar composite. We had this initial batch of rain and thunderstorms that moved through a little bit earlier. And again, the sun allowed for some more thunderstorms to develop off to our south and west. And look at this. We have another batch heading in our direction. That's just west of 95. So unfortunately, we're going to be dealing with some of these strong storms over the next few hours, I would say as late as 10 o'clock tonight. Here's our convective outlook, and you can see our entire viewing area shaded in this yellow color, indicating that slight risk for some severe thunderstorms over the next few hours. Our potential impacts here, some strong gusty winds, again now potentially in excess of 70 miles per hour. We could see some decent sized hail, anywhere from the size of a quarter up to the size of a ping pong ball or a golf ball. Flooding is not the biggest concern. We're not really expecting any flash flooding or anything like that, but we certainly could see some ponding and puddling on the roads. And again, there's the possible impact of a tornado. Here's a look at our future track forecast. Here we are at 7 o'clock, and you can see that next batch that is just west of 95. That'll continue to move in our direction. Looks like things won't really start to quiet down until we get closer to 10 o'clock tonight, a few stray showers expected then. But overall, as we go through the overnight hours, we expect decreasing clouds. So by tomorrow morning, we're looking at a mixture of sunshine and clouds. Temperatures will start off in the mid-50s and top out in the upper 60s during the afternoon. So kicking off the weekend on a really beautiful note here, and even going into Sunday, things are going to be nice and bright for us. We'll have lots of sunshine on Sunday with a high of 60 degrees, partly sunny on Monday with a high of 67. Then we could be talking about some on and off showers for next Tuesday, and they're kind of in and out of the shower chances going through the second half of the week. All of our latest forecast updates are at wavy.com.
Straight ahead on WAVY News 10 at 5, Governor Terry McAuliffe is taking a stand against excessive tolls. Our Andy Fox will explain how his toll reform plan could impact you.
A Virginia Beach man accused of poisoning his wife was in court today. Find out what prosecutors say he injected her with.
Then all new at 5:30, we're just over 2 months away from the June primaries. What are the races to watch, and are there any surprises after yesterday's filing deadline? And it's the virus that just won't go away. The flu is hanging on in Virginia. What you can do to not become a victim of the sniffles, sneezes, and fever, all new at 6.
But first, ahead here at 4, new bike giveaway. Where and why these students all got a new ride. Every student at one South Carolina elementary school has a brand new ride. A first grade teacher raised enough money to buy every kid there a bicycle. 650 students received the new bikes yesterday. Katie Bloomquist initially started a campaign on GoFundMe for one student who wanted a bike that she couldn't afford. Then she set a goal of raising enough money, $65,000, to buy a bike for everyone. Each child also received a helmet and a lock. The campaign raised more money than they needed, so Bloomquist says she plans to use the rest to start a nonprofit to do similar things across the country. Great idea. Well, not such a great day to ride a bike in Hampton Roads. We are tracking some severe weather right now on WAVY News 10 at 5.
Now, from the station on your side, this is WAVY News 10.
We've got to right the ship. It's a big challenge. We've got to put a different face on customer service.
This is the new captain of ERC. How he plans on changing the way they do business here.